Good morning, students. We discussed multiprocessing, multitasking, multitasking types, task scheduling types, and task communication types in the previous video. Let's move on to the next topic today. So this is a inter-process communication diagram. Inter-process communication, that is IPC, is a mechanism that enables processes to interact with one another and synchronize their activities. Remote procedure call, that is RPC, is an inter-process communication mechanism used by one process to call a procedure of another processor operating on the same or separate CPU, that is interconnected in a network. RPC is also known as remote invocation or remote method invocation. In the object-oriented language terminology, RPC is mostly used for distributed applications such as client-server applications. It is possible to communicate over a heterogeneous network using RPC. The server is the CPU or process that contains the procedure that must be activated remotely. The CPU or process that initiates an RPC request is referred to as the client. RPC communication can be completed using various innovation interfaces. To ensure that RPC communication is consistent across all devices, some standard format should be followed. The interfaces for RPC are specified by the Interface Definition Language, that is IDL. Microsoft IDL, that is MIDL, is Microsoft IDL implementation for all Microsoft platform. RPC communication may be synchronous or asynchronous, that is blocking or non-blocking type. In synchronous communication, the mechanism that calls the remote procedure is blocked before it receives a response from the other process. In a synchronous RPC calls, the calling process continues its execution while the remote process executes the operation. The outcome of the remote procedure is returned to the caller through mechanism similar to a callback functions. Sockets are used for RPC communication. A socket is a logical endpoint in a two-way communication connection between two network connector applications. There are various types of sockets such as internet socket, Unix socket, and so on. The internet network protocol is used by the INET, that is internet socket. INET sockets are networking protocols such as TCP or IP and UDP and others. INET sockets are listed as follows. The first one, stream socket. Second one, datagram socket. Stream socket are link oriented and use TCP to create a trustworthy connection. Okay, TCP to create a trustworthy connection. UDP is used to create a link between datagram sockets. As compared to TCP, the UDP link is unreliable. The next slide shows concept of semaphore. Semaphore is a simply a variable that is a non-negative and shared between threads. A semaphore is a signaling mechanism, and a thread that is waiting on a semaphore can be signaled by another thread. A semaphore either allows or disallows access to the resource, which depends on how it is set up. So, semaphore is a mutual exclusion implementation based on wait and release for shared resource access. A semaphore is a system resource, and the process that wants to use the shared resource should first acquire the system object to show to the other processes that want to that want the shared resources, that is actually acquired by it. The resources shared by the process may be used exclusively by one process or by a number of processes at the same time. A common example of a shared resource that requires exclusively access by the mechanism is an embedded system display screen. Okay, a system hard disk is a standard example of a sharing a resource among a listed number of multiple processes. Several processes can access various sectors of the hard disk at the same time. Then semaphores are divided into two categories based on how the sharing constraint of the shared resource is implemented. The first one, binary semaphore. Second one, counting semaphore. The binary semaphore provides exclusive access to shared resources by allocating the resource to a single process at a time and preventing other processes from accessing it when it is owned by a process. The implementation of a binary semaphore is dependent on the operating system kernel. It is referred to as a mutex in some operating system kernels. A counting semaphore keeps a count between a zero and a value. It restricts the use of a resource to the full value of the count it supports. When the count of the counting semaphore object exceeds, the state is set to signaled. When a process or thread acquires a semaphore object, the count is set to 1 and the count is incremented by 1 when the semaphore object is released. Okay, so when the semaphore is obtained by the maximum number of processes or threads that the semaphore can accommodate the object's state, is set to non-signaled. So this is the next topic, that is a priority inversion and priority inheritance. Let's see the first one, that is a priority inversion. The combination of a blocking based process synchronization and preemptive priority scheduling results in priority inversion. Priority inversion occurs when a high priority task must wait for low priority task to release a resource that is shared between high priority task and the low priority task, whereas a medium priority task does not need the shared resource will begin its execution by preempting the low priority task. So, the priority based preventive scheduling ensures that a high priority tasks are always performed first, where a process lock based process synchronization ensures that a process cannot access a sharing resource currently used by another process. The synchronization technique is only concerned with the preventing conflict that may occur as a result of concurrent access to the shared resource and is unconcerned about the priority of the mechanism that attempt to access the shared resource. The two primitive operating system conflicting are the priority prevention and lock based synchronization. See the concept of a priority inversion diagram. Job 1 is waiting for job 2 to complete an activity, while job 3 took priority over job 2. So this also postponed the execution of a job 1. Then priority inheritance. Priority inheritance means a low priority task that is currently accessing a shared resources requested by a high priority task temporarily inherits the high priority task priority from the time the high priority task activate the request. So increasing the priority of the low priority task to that of the priority of the task that is requested, the shared resource eliminates preemption of the low priority task by the other task whose priority is lower than that of the task that requested the shared resources, and therefore reduces the delay in waiting for the resource requested by the low priority task. When the shared resource is released, the priority of the low priority task that was temporarily raised to high, that is returned to its original value. Priority inheritance is simply a workaround that that eliminates the pause in waiting for the high priority task to obtain the resource from the low priority task. The only difference is that it allows the low priority role to proceed and release the shared resource as soon as possible. So this slide shows the VXOS. Wind River System VXOS is a popular hot real-time multitasking operating system. For real-time extension, it is a fully compatible with a POSIX format. It is a compatible with a wide range of target processors and controllers, including Intel 8086 ARM processor, MIPS, Power PC and 68K. So the VXWorks kernel is commonly referred to as Wind. The new version of VXWorks incorporates the principle of symmetric multiprocessing, that is SMP, making it easier to build multi-core processor based real-time system. VXWorks RTOS platform is used in numerous applications across aerospace and defense application to robotics and industrial device networking, consumer electronics and vehicle navigation and telematics systems. So the task-based execution model is used by VXWorks. It is possible to run a subroutine, so separate a task with its own context and standard under the VXWorks kernel. For task scheduling, the Wind kernel employs a priority-based policy. Inter-task communication is accomplished by the use of a message queue, sockets, pipes and signals, and task synchronization is accomplished through the use of semaphore. Okay, then here the first one is a task creating and management. So at any given time, the task in the VXWorks kernel can be one of the following primary state or a specific combination of them. The first one is a ready. Ready is nothing but the task is prepared for execution and is awaiting its turn to receive the CPU. The next state, that is a pending state, the task is in a blocked state because it is awaiting some resources. Then third state, that is a delay, the task is to sleep. Then fourth one, suspend, the task is paused for execution. This condition is mainly used to pause a task for debugging purpose. Suspending a task prevents it from being executed but does not prevent it from changing states. So a suspended task has the ability to alter its task state. A task can be completed from its creation state, or it can be paused or postponed or suspended during execution. If a task is picked up for execution by the scheduler and suppose another task of higher priority becomes ready for execution, and if the scheduling policy is a preemptive priority based, the currently executing task is preempted and a high priority task is executed. So the preempted task enters the ready state. If a currently executing task requires a shared resource which is currently held by another task, the currently executing task is preempted and it enters the pending state. and until the resource is released by the task holding it. If a task contains sleeping requirement like polling an external device at a periodic interval or sampling data from the external world at a periodic time, the task sleeps during the periodic interval. The task is said to be delay state during this time. If a debug request for debugging a task in execution, or if an exception happens during the execution of a task, it is moved to the state that is suspended. Okay, then second one, that is task scheduling. So VxWorks support two different scheduling interfaces. The first one is a POSIX scheduling interface, second one WIND scheduling interface. Let's see the POSIX scheduling interface. It interfaces that is this type of interface is based on the idea of processes and specifies a portable interface, while WIND scheduling is based on task. The POSIX task scheduling standard allows you to set scheduling policies for each process independently. However, separate scheduling policies for different tasks are not possible with the VxWorks implementation of the POSIX scheduling interface. It only supports a single system wide scheduling policy for the various tasks that run on it. VxWorks embraces two types of scheduling policies. The first one is a round robin and a priority based preemptive. Okay, the round robin scheduling policy is used to determine priority among tasks of equal priority. More than one task with equal priority is in the ready state, and currently executed task has the same priority. However, if the scheduling policy is used in a preemptive, these tasks must be unable to preempt the currently operating task due to the equal priority. Okay, then third one, that is a kernel services. Okay, kernel services. So VxWorks kernel functionalities are often implemented as tasks, which are referred to as a system task. The system task coexists with the user identified task. The scheduler first task is to run the root task, user router. The root task is a user customizable. Then the user can add any additional initialization code that is required during kernel build process. Then fourth one, inter-task communication, stored memory, message queue, pipes, sockets, then remote procedure call and signaling are used to promote inter-task communication. Semaphores are used to enforce mutual exclusive and synchronization in shared resource across or resource access. For activities, that is a VxWorks kernel uses a signal linear address space. Data can be exchanged using global variable, a linear buffer, related list and ring buffers. The primary inter-task communication mechanism in VxWorks is the message queue. Message queue allows for a two-way communication of variable length message. Then the next one, that is a task synchronization and mutual exclusion. VxWorks uses a data sharing of one of its inter-task coordination mechanism. For all user tasks, VxWorks confirm to a single linear address space. Sharing data is critical for the task synchronization. Mutual exclusion policies are implemented in three ways by VxWorks. They are task locking, disabling interrupt, and third one is locking the resource with semaphores. The shared exclusive semaphore has the option of setting its priority to the highest priority of the task, that is being paused when attempting to obtain a semaphore that is already in use by a low priority task. The next one, interrupt handling. So this is a sixth function, interrupt handling. For managing hardware interrupt, VxWorks provide a well-defined interrupt handling mechanism. External interrupt should be handled efficiently and quickly in real-time system. The next one, watchdog for task execution monitoring. So here, watchdog timer are critical for getting the device back up after a system hangup. If a task hangs at some stage during the execution due to an unpredictable situation, it should be removed from the situation to keep the machine running. For this, a watchdog timer are used. When the task is started or when the task is executing in the suspected portion of the code, start the watchdog timer. If the task or a portion of the task is not completed within the time limit the specified in the watchdog timer, so the watchdog timer expires and arises a watchdog time out case. So the watchdog time out handler can be used to write down the appropriate steps to manage the situation. Watchdog timer timeout is done as part of the system clock ISR in VxWorks. The watchdog timer can be associated with C feature. So when the watchdog timer expires, the C function is the name. When the watchdog expires, the C function is can be stopped. The watchdog timer can be stopped and cancelled at any time until it expires by calling the WD cancel parenthesis, open parenthesis and close parenthesis function. Okay, the next one, timing and reference. Many scenarios can require the use of a timing reference. VxWorks gives you access to the system wide real time clock for timing purpose. So these interfaces can be used to create software timers and time reference. The task will build a timer and set it to a desired time for timer operation. The timer produces the signal as the device timer ticks. When it expires, signal alarm in the event that the timer expires, the task will associate a signal handler with this signal to perform the appropriate operation. Okay, then the last one, that is a VxWork development environment. Wind River System Tornado is the development of environment for a VxWorks 5.x. It contains the Tornado tool as well as VxWorks runtime environment. Tornado tools provide an integrated development environment, that is IDE, for operating system customization and development. Simulator for simulating the target environment and a debug interface for debugging. Tornado 2 development environment are available for both Windows and Linux host. Then the Ellipse based IDE Wind River Workbench for VxWorks 6.x has replaced by Tornado IDE. Okay.
So this is about VxWorks functions. Then this slide shows the micro C or operating system 2. Micro C or operating system 2 is a simple user-friendly real-time kernel written in the C computer language for embedded application development. Microcontroller operating system version 2 is abbreviated as micro C or operating system 2. The microcontroller our operating system 2 features are as follows. The first one, multitasking. The second one, priority based preemptive task scheduling. Here MicroM INCs, microcontroller or operating system 2, is a commercial real time micro C or operating system 2 kernel is available for various processor or controller families, and it is support processor or controller ranging from 8 bit to 64 bit. Some of the processor or controller supports by Micro C or operating system 2 include the ARM family of processor, Intel 8085, 8086, 8051, Freescale 68K series, and Altair NEOS 2. The task based execution model is used by microcontroller or operating system 2. So each activity is carried out as an infinite loop. Then, so these are the functions of a Micro C or operating system 2. The first one is a task creation and management. The task in the operating the task in the microcontroller C operating system 2 kernel can be one of the following states at any given time. Here dormant, that is the dormant state is the state in which a task is generated but no resources are assigned to it. So this means that that the task is still in program memory and has no and has not been transferred to RAM for execution. Then first state is called as a ready state. This corresponds to a state in which the task has been inserted into the memory and is waiting for its turn to be executed by the CPU. Then running state. So this is the state in which the operation is being performed by the CPU. The next one, waiting state, a condition in which a running task is temporarily suspended from execution and does not have immediate access to resources. Then fourth one, interrupted. When an interrupt occurs, a task enters the ISR or interrupted state, the CPU executes the ISR. Then third one, second one, kernel functions and initialization. This is the second function. Before performing user task, the kernel must be initialized and started. Micro C or operating systems 2 provides a kernel initialization and start routines for the operating system. Micro C or operating system 2 kernel initialization and operating system kernel start are written as a part of the startup code, which is executed before user task are executed. So here command is OS init, that is a OS kernel initialization module. So this is called first. So it carries out the following task. The first one is initialize the different operating system kernel data structure, then creates the ideal task, that is OS idle, open parenthesis, close parenthesis. Then the ideal task is the lowest priority task in the Micro C operating system 2 kernel, and it is performed to keep the CPU busy when no user tasks are available. Idle activities cannot be deleted or suspended by user task. Okay, then third one, that is a task scheduling. Preemptive priority based scheduling is supported by the Micro C or operating system 2. Each task should be assigned a specific priority level ranging from 0 to 61, with 0 being the highest. The four highest and the four lowest goal are set aside the kernel, aside for kernel. When the kernel boosts, it runs the first available high priority task. If any of the following situation arises, the assignment is rescheduled. When a high priority task becomes ready to run, or when a task reaches a waiting state due to a system call invocation, that is when an interrupt happens, the task are rescheduled when the ISR returns. Okay, then the next one is inter-task communication. Okay, inter-task communication. So this is the fourth function. The following inter-process communication technique are supported by the Micro C or operating system 2 kernel for data sharing and task cooperation. The first one is mailbox, the second one a message queue. So the functionality of a mailbox and a message queue is the same. The only difference between them is the number of messages they will support. Both are used to send data in the form of message from one task to another or from the ISR to a task. Mailbox are used to send a single message between two tasks or between an ISR and a task. Mailbox associates a point to the mailbox and a wait list to keep activities that are waiting for a response in the mailbox. Then fifth function, that is a mutual exclusion and a task synchronization. Here multiple tasks run simultaneously in a multitasking environment sharing device, resource and data. To avoid data theft and race condition, access to shared resource should be made mutually exclusive. Task use synchronization method to synchronize their execution. The following strategies are used by microcontroller or operating system 2 to provide the exclusive access to shared resources. So under this, the first one, disabling task scheduling, then disabling interrupt, then semaphore for mutual exclusion, even for synchronization. So these are the following strategies that is used by microcontroller or operating system. Shared resources. The next one, timing and reference. So this is the sixth function. The clock time, that is the clock ticker, serve as the time source, providing a reference for a time delay and a timeout. Clock tick creates an interrupt on a regular basis. To handle a clock ticker, the clock ticker interrupt should be activated. To serve the clock ticker interrupt, the clock ticker is ISR call. The feature, that is operating system time ticker. The operating system ticks per second configuration parameter must be properly set for the device timer to operate properly. It specifies the number of clock ticks, that is a number of clock ticks in 1 second. Okay, so it is determined by the target board clock frequency. Okay, then that is a the next slide, that is it shows the memory partitioning under micro C or operating system 2 memory management system. So here micro C or operating systems 2 allows the runtime memory allocation deallocation as required. The memory segmented into many sectors. Each sector is divided further into blocks. Each block has a fixed amount of memory. Each partition has at least two memory blocks. The block size is consistent over a partition. Each memory partition is associated with the memory control block, that is MCB. Then next one, interrupt handler. Each interrupt in micro C or operating system 2 is assigned an interrupt request number, that is IRQ. A function calls ISR is used to execute the behavior that lead to an interrupt. The IRQ is linked to the appropriate ISR. The ISR includes a code for saving CPU registers and restoring them when the ISR is back. A register saving instruction or processor dependent and are usually written in processor specific assembly language. The ISR can be implemented in a C function if the cross assembler, that is a cross compiler, allows assembly code to be mixed with a C. Nested interrupts with a nesting level of 255 are supported by micro C or operating system 2. Okay, then micro C operating system 2 development environment. So here various processor manufacturers can provide an IDE for micro C based development in addition to the development of a micro C or operating system 2 port for that device. So Ultra NIOS 2 IDE is an IDE designed for Altra's NIOS 2 processor family. Third party developer can also provide IDE for Micro C or operating system 2 creation. For different processor architecture, third party development tools such as Micro IDE is an example. It is compatible with the following Micro C compiler, that is 6808, 6809, 11, 12, 16, then AVR, then 8051 or 52, 8080 or 85, 8086 and 8096. Okay, so these are the functions of Micro C or operating system 2. So totally it contains 9 functions. Task creation and management, kernel functions and initialization, task scheduling, inter-task communication, mutual exclusion and task synchronization, timing and reference, memory management, interrupt handling, then last one, the Micro C or operating system 2 development environment. Okay, then RT Linux. That is RT Linux. Actually, POSIX hot real-time environment with the real-time code is an expansion of the Linux version that previously did not have real-time support. The core is known as RT Linux Free, the RT Linux Pro. And it is available as a freeware and commercial software respectively. There are a few easy changes that turn the non-real-time Linux kernel with a round-robin scheduler into the hot real-time environment. ISR executes a deterministic interrupt latency at RT Linux. And all indeterministic processing tasks are passed to Linux. The forwarded Linux functions are placed in a FIFO queue with a memory shared between RT Linux threads as the highest priority and Linux functions running as the lowest priority threads. So this is the diagram that shows the RT Linux basic features. See here, the first one, that is running the task in the following configuration results in excellent real-time efficiency. So use only one statically allocated memory to run the primitive task. Dynamic memory allocation, also known as a virtual memory allocation, introduces unpredictability in allocation and low timings. Use no address space protection while running the real-time task. Memory address protection requires additional check, which results in volatile allocation and load timings. Then after that, run with the interrupt disabled so that the other interrupt do not introduce unpredictability. Running a straightforward fixed priority scheduler. With the FIFO, connect the real-time task with the Linux processor. Perform synchronization between hard real-time task and limited size FIFO queues using shared memory. Okay, then soft real-time system can be programmed to run in a variety of ways since RT, that is RT Linux kernel has been built with your modules that can be replaced to make the behavior versatile. Wherever possible, the RT Linux enables flexibility in defining the real-time behavior, synchronization and communication. Non-real-time application process run as Linux processes. Then features of RT Linux. So the following features RT Linux are useful in the design of a real-time embedded system. The first one is a small footprint core. The core function is the same way as a virtual machine layer. The RT Linux core includes a kernel that are both preempting and non-preempting. Then the executive of RT Linux cannot be preempted. Then real-time task run is a privileged mode, which allows them to directly access the hardware rather than rely on virtual memory. Real-time tasks are written as special Linux modules. that can be loaded dynamically into the memory. The deterministic worst case latency for the number of processor tests, that is 8086 ARM processor MIPS for prolonged period of severe load is very low. Then the CPU may be allocated to various real-time threads such as those used in media processing. Priority is implemented and set for a task, and as a repetition rate scheduling algorithm can be chosen. Then RT Linux provides excellent average case efficiency, and real-time thread follow strict worst case limited deadlines. Then POSIX thread APIs confirmed to the POSIX 131.13 PSE 51 specification. The above is the specification of a minimal real-time machine model with the POSIX IPC. The lowest priority thread are Linux or Unix function that use the shared memory, lock free queue and shared memory. So this is the diagram which RT Linux based future diagram. So far we covered inter-process communication, semaphore, priority inversion and priority inheritance, VxWorks, Micro C, our operating system 2, RT Linux and features of RT Linux. And we have come to the end of unit 4. Thank you.